Hey everybody, this is Chemical Kinetics for AP Chemistry in 10 minutes or less. This video is meant as a refresher on some of the major topics in Unit 5 of the 2021 version of AP Chemistry. It is intended for students who have already learned the material and are beginning to prepare for the AP Chemistry exam. For anyone that cares, it's going to cover the following topics from the AP Chemistry course and exam description. Let's get started. So when you think about kinetics, or chemical kinetics in particular, there's kind of two things that should come to your mind. And the first one is imagining how reactions happen on the atomic scale. And we can actually answer that question very simply by saying that reactions are going to happen when there are collisions between the reactant particles. If you dig a little bit deeper, however, you'll see that those collisions not only have to happen, but they have to have sufficient energy in order to break the bonds between the reactant particles. And the reactant particles themselves have to be pointed towards each other in the proper orientation when the collision happens, so that the correct bonds are broken, allowing for the formation of new bonds in creating the products. When you start analyzing these different factors that affect the collisions between reactant particles, you start to realize that you are talking about the explanations behind what is known as reaction rates. In other words, the study of how fast or slow a reaction occurs. So the first really important thing we're going to list out here are some factors that affect these reaction rates. In other words, what are some things that control whether or not a reaction proceeds quickly or more slowly? The first of those factors is surface area. This really is only a consideration if your reactants are solids. If your solid reactant has more surface area, that's essentially a larger space where collisions can occur, so you're going to get more collisions that can take place along that surface. And since we're getting more collisions, that's going to correspond to a faster reaction rate. A second factor to consider is the temperature of the reactants. If your reactants are at a higher temperature, that means the particles are moving more quickly and with more kinetic energy. This means that not only will there be more collisions between particles, a higher percentage of those collisions will have sufficient energy to start breaking some of the bonds between the reactants. This, of course, will lead to a faster reaction rate. Another factor is the presence of a third-party substance known as a catalyst. So if a catalyst is present where the reaction is taking place, it's going to speed up that reaction rate through a process known as catalysis. And this catalysis can happen a number of different ways, but regardless of the method, they all pretty much have the same effect. To see how they work, let's take a look at this energy profile diagram for an uncatalyzed reaction. So we'll have one line to represent the reactants and the approximate energy value that those reactants have, and then another line to represent the potential energy value of the products. In order for the reactants to turn into the products, there's usually some sort of an energy barrier that has to be overcome. The height of that peak represents the value of that energy barrier and is often called the activation energy, symbolized capital E sub A. Now, in the uncatalyzed reaction, that means there is no catalyst present, that activation energy peak is pretty high. That means there's lots of this sufficient energy that we talked about earlier that's going to be required when those reactant molecules collide with each other in order for the reaction to occur. If those particles don't meet this energy barrier or don't have that sufficient energy, they're going to collide and just bounce off of each other unchanged. In other words, the reaction will not occur. For this reason, when the activation energy is higher, like we have here in the uncatalyzed reaction, the entire reaction is going to occur slower. If a catalyst is present, however, we'll draw a second energy profile diagram to see how it affects these energy values. Now, the reactants remain unchanged and the products remain unchanged. The catalyst offers an alternate pathway for this reaction to occur, and that alternate pathway requires less activation energy. Since the activation energy is lower, that means the molecules that collide don't have to have as much energy in those collisions in order for a reaction to occur when they happen. As a result, more of the molecules will meet this minimum energy value as they collide with each other, and the reaction will proceed at a faster reaction rate. This is often explained with something called a Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution graph that shows the number of molecules in a sample that have certain energy values. That graph is usually some type of a curve shape that looks like this. Now on this graph, let's plot out this high activation energy and where that might fall. Since it's a high activation energy, maybe it falls somewhere up here at these higher energy values. Now I can shade in the number of molecules that will have or exceed that energy value. So it's only these molecules that I've shaded in where when they collide with each other have enough energy to cause a reaction to take place. And you can see that it's just not very many. The vast majority of the molecules down here, when they collide, won't have enough energy and the reaction doesn't happen. That's why these reactions with high activation energies go fairly slow. If a catalyst comes in, however, it lowers that activation energy. So now my energy barrier is down here. If I shade in the number of molecules that will have this minimum amount of energy, you can see it's a lot more. That means more of the particles, when they collide, will have enough energy to react, and the reaction goes faster. The final factor that can affect a reaction rate is the concentration of the reactants themselves. The general guideline is that if there is a higher concentration of reactants, you're going to get more collisions and a faster reaction rate. Now with reactant concentration, there's a little bit more to explore, including something known as reaction order. You can think about reaction order like a numerical expression of just how much the reactant concentration will affect the rate of the reaction. For example, if your reaction was zeroth order, a graph of concentration over time would be a perfectly straight line that looks like this. That means that it doesn't matter if the molarity is super high up here or in the middle down here or super low, the slope of this line remains constant at all concentrations, which means the reaction is happening just as fast no matter what the concentration was. In other words, the reaction was going the same rate at all concentrations. Since the rate was staying the same no matter what the molarity was, if you graphed the rate itself as time progressed, you would see a straight horizontal line because the rate was not changing. For first and second order reactions, the reactant concentration does have an effect on how fast your reaction goes. As a result, the graph of concentration versus time will have a curve shape to it. First order might look something like this, and sometimes second order is a little bit more pronounced. If you look at the first order graph where the concentration is higher, the slope of that line is very steep. That means the concentration is changing a lot and the reaction is happening faster. If you look further down, however, at a lower concentration, the slope levels off, meaning the concentration does not change as much and the reaction has slowed down. Since the rate slows over time, if you graphed rate versus time for a first order reaction, you would see the line look something like this. Notice the linear decrease in the reaction rate as time goes on. Now for second order reactions, there's a decrease in rate over time as well. They go much faster when the concentration is high and much slower when the concentration is low, but the relationship between rate and time is not linear. Instead, you would get a gentle curve shape. So identifying these reaction orders is pretty simple for a zeroth order reaction because that concentration versus time graph is going to be a straight line. But it's harder to tell the difference between a first and second order reaction based only on a molarity versus time graph. Now we have sort of a little graphical trick we can use to help tell the difference between these two types. If you made a graph, not of concentration versus time, but of natural log of concentration versus time, and if that graph came out as a straight line, that's only going to be true for a first order reaction. For second order reactions, a graph of the inverse of those concentrations versus time, that would give you a straight line graph that looks like this. So how can you identify these reaction orders? One way is by analyzing the shapes of the different graphs like we just talked about. You can also tell the order by looking at experimental data in what is called the method of initial rates. That experimental data shows up in tables that look like this. I can see here that if the concentration of A doubles, that doubling seems to have no effect on the reaction rate. That means A must be zero order. That zeroth order for A is then expressed in something called a rate law or rate expression, where I use the concentration of A with an exponent of zero. I can also see that as the concentration of B doubles, it causes the rate to also double. That means B must be first order. So in my rate law, the concentration of B gets an exponent of 1. finally, I can determine reaction order by looking at something called mechanism steps. Here's some sample mechanism steps. You can see step one and step two. I could add these together and cancel off intermediates like X that show up on opposite sides of the reaction arrow. I've also been told that step one is the slower of the two steps, which makes it something called the rate determining step. That means I can write the rate law for the overall reaction simply by looking at the coefficients of the two reactants, A and B. Here those coefficients are both 1 and 1, and those coefficients can become the order of A and the order of B. This rate law for the slow step will also be the rate law for the overall reaction. It's really important to remember, though, that you can only ever use coefficients as your orders for mechanism steps. You cannot do that for the coefficients in an overall reaction. And lastly, it would be really nice if we had some way where we could calculate exact molarity changes as they take place over time. Of course, we have equations for that. They are known as the integrated rate laws. Now there's three different equations, one for each reaction order that you're likely to see, zero, first, and second. All of these are given to you, of course, on the AP equation sheet. And while all three look very different, you'll see they have the same basic pieces, like the concentration at some time, the concentration at some initial time, the rate constant, lowercase k, from your rate law, and the time itself. And that wraps it up for Chemical Kinetics for AP Chemistry in 10-ish minutes or less. Thanks for watching.